And now our exclusive interview with one of the world leading water scientists, Dr. Kaveh Madani. Kaveh is an environmental scientist, educator and activist working at the interface of science, policy and society. He is known internationally for his work on integrating game theory into water resources management. He is the former deputy head of Iran's Department of Environment and former vice president of the UN Environment Assembly Bureau. He is the visiting professor at Imperial College London and Henry Hart Rice Senior Fellow at the Macmillan Center for International and Area Studies of Yale University. Kaveh, it is a pleasure to have you with us today. You should know that my view on water issues and the water-related environmental challenges have massively changed because of your work and activism in the field. I know that the issue of water has been undermined massively in global conversations, and I'm very pleased that we have dedicated a session to this very important topic at ChangeNow this year. Dr. Madani, clean water is a human right and has been recognized by the UN since 2010, and yet water-related challenges, as mentioned earlier, seem to not have been given the attention it deserves. Why do you think that is?
Thanks for the invitation and having me here. I'm glad that my publications and work had some effect on your work and what you're doing and how you are informing people. I'm also glad that ChangeNow is now covering water and is recognizing it as a as an important subject, which has been really overlooked. You know, we heard from the panelists about the work, the other panelists about the work they are doing. What we need to learn and understand and appreciate is that there is a big difference between physical water unavailability or physical water shortage and economic water shortage. We commonly hear the word poverty next to water shortage, but in the case of poor communities, the problem is not necessarily the lack of water in terms of natural availability, but what it means is that the governments and those in charge of managing water in those regions have not been able to provide water to the citizens because of economic problems, because of political issues and other struggles, which are very common in some of the developing nations, especially if they are being run undemocratically they're suffering from unsustainable development and uneven development. So this is an important issue where we see water is not being recognized as a human right. We also see other rights of the humans not being respected. And that reminds us the important fact that if we want to solve the problems of the developing nations, of the global South, of the whole world, we have to understand the problems on the ground and what people are doing. In many cases, the problem is not the technology. It is only the lack of governance systems and the way water is valued in communities and water is being managed by the system. And I think this pandemic taught us this in the very first days when the smart people in our side of the world came up with the solution of washing hands. They forgot the fact that there are many people on this planet who don't have access to water for their sanitation and health. And this is something that we dismiss a lot of times. The amount of water we talk about when it comes to human rights is the amount we are talking about 50 liters of water or so, and that is not massive, and that is something that we have to work on.
The world's population almost quadrupled in the last century, but demand for water grew at double that rate. Over the next 50 years or so, it is estimated that most people and more people and changing lifestyles will need yet another 55% more water. How will we and how can we balance demand for water while producing the food, goods, and power needed for the future?
You mentioned the key word here, lifestyle. Unless we change this lifestyle, we cannot, do that. There is a limit to growth, and water is definitely a big limit to growth, as we have seen this in many parts of the world. Look at the Middle East right now, the problem that have arisen because of putting too much, the pressure of economy on water. Water not only provides food for us, not only it provides health and safety and sanitation and food and energy to us, but also there are lots of people whose jobs are dependent on water. But this way of development cannot continue. And if we are actually helping some of the poor communities in the world, we also need to understand this and try to come up with solutions which are different. Now you are also mentioning something about demand, and that is also an important thing, because a lot of times our solutions are very supply oriented. We come up with technologies, we invent technologies, and we are proud of the new technologies that we develop. We came up with the technology of pumps and pumping groundwater. Then we build dams. Then we build desalination plants. Then we transfer water from one location to another. And now we are thinking about even taking water out of air. These are good. These solutions can be used, but they cannot completely address this supply-demand gap. We need policy interventions and technological innovations, and most importantly, a change of the way we run our economies and lifestyle to cut the demand meaningfully and get the world out of this water bankruptcy situation.
My next question might be a little bit similar to what you've just said, because you mentioned the technology. So as technology advances with new solutions for our existing problems, just what you said, we can see that the balance is sort of being interrupted. Drip irrigation comes to mind, and how water conservation in irrigation, for instance, can increase water use. So we need the balance here as well. What do you think we should do? Just talk us through that as well.
Yeah, I mean, let me explain this, because this might be shocking to people. I read an article on Iran's water resources today, and I saw a solution being proposed by someone there as drip irrigation can solve the narrative that drip irrigation can solve the problem. And this is an old saying. This is not new. But what we have learned is that wherever we increase water supply, no matter what mechanism, you dig a well or build a dam or transfer water or desalinate water, you increase supply. When you increase supply, there is a perception of water availability, and water becomes an engine of growth. With growth, there would be development. With development, there is change of lifestyle, population growth, more demand for food, changing from vegetables to meat diet, and increasing demand. So what happens is that the your investment in the supply actually can increase the gap between supply and demand in the long run, or let's say it result in the demand growth. This doesn't mean that technologies are bad. This means that technologies must be implemented together with other things, especially economic and policy interventions, which make sure that the demand is also regulated at the same time. Now, speaking of irrigation efficiency, what we learned in the world was that when we changed the irrigation efficiency to drip irrigation, replace flood irrigation with drip irrigation, yes, it is good because it increases the water efficiency of use. Now, so the water efficiency. Now, what happens is that before we have flood irrigation, part of the water was getting evaporated, part of the water was getting infiltrated in our underground resources and going into springs and rivers and so on. Now, as a result of drip irrigation and too much efficiency, we lose our return flow. It's good for evaporation, but we lose our return flow. So then farmers are also smart. They realize they have warm water available, so they either expand their land area, you know, farming area, or switch their crops. So they go after, you know, crops which are thirstier. So our water use increases as the result of this technological improvement. Now, is that bad? No. Technological improvement can be implemented, but if you implement it without regulating water, without metering it, you know, some of the solutions that we had, and you know, we heard in this the panel discussion in your session. So these solutions must be accompanied by this sort of invention. And most importantly, we have to realize water rights. We have to realize, like, you know, the extent of water withdrawal, what is sustainable. You cannot withdraw more than your renewable water rate, and so many other things, which if we have the complete bundle, we can improve the situation. If we don't, we can actually exacerbate this situation and make it worse. And as this is proven already.
As a person in the field of sustainability and sustainable development, I'm always cautious about the concept of virtual water and water footprint, for instance, in the food and agriculture or energy sector. A hidden concept, as it were, something I believe we need to pay more attention to, but I don't think that we do. Can you talk us through that?
A very good question, and I think, you know, it also, this is connected to your first question. Why haven't we done enough for water as an essential element of life? I mean, it's a resource we cannot survive without. One of the reasons is that we don't know or constantly think about where water is being used. Most of the water in the world goes into the agricultural sector to produce food. Any product that we use, you know, coming out of industry, coming out of the agricultural sector, no matter what, uses some amount of water. So during the process of producing a product or even a service, some water is being used. Now that water, the embedded water in the product, is not being recognized by us, and it's not even being priced properly, right? We buy food. Bread is pretty cheap compared, you know, to its value. Food is cheap. Governments around the world have to keep food cheap and available because they care about the survivals of their citizens. And without food, people die. So the end product is very cheap, and we don't value and think about the material which goes into the production. Now, so any product we use, it has some embedded water or virtual water. Now, where does your product come from? So the shirt I'm wearing might be coming from somewhere in East Asia, for example. In East Asia, people have irrigated cotton. Some water has gone into the production of this, and now I buy this in the United States and wear it without thinking what sort of water has gone into this, where is it coming from, and if the people over there have access to sustainable water resources or not, are they water bankrupt or not? The food I eat, whatever, it's delicious, I don't think about it. The meat I might be eating, I don't think about these things. Now, every product that we use comes from somewhere in the world. And if we think about it, you know, water is being virtually traded. So every product has water footprint. And if you don't think about this water footprint, then you don't really think about the water rights of people. Now, if you start thinking about this, if you start, you know, noticing this and even asking about this, questioning, you know, asking for a label which provides that information, then we can think about the justice implications of what is happening. I buy this shirt very cheap, and the farmer in East Asia never get paid properly to protect the water, and the governments even in those regions don't get paid properly, and we see a situation that we are seeing today. The poor countries of the world, many poor countries of the world, are supplying food to us, which is very cheap compared to what they buy from us, which is technology and service. This is totally unfair. This is unjust, and this attitude of us must change. We don't have to necessarily travel to Africa and East Asia to solve problems. We can solve the problems where we live if we think about these things and change our lifestyle and the way we think.
Kaveh, thank you for your valuable contribution. It's always a pleasure listening to you. It is indeed imperative to gain the participation of experts in the field. I hope our audience enjoyed our discussion on this very important topic. Thanks for joining us.